Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Life and Development Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of life and development that govern the operation of God's laws. Gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 19th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Well, now we come to the life and development principles. Good principles, these two. All of them are good principles, yes. Yes. Okay, well, let's start with our life principles. What are they about? Obviously, it's a very key principle, isn't it? Because otherwise we wouldn't even have life. So it's a very key principle. So let's look at again a summary. The life principles transfer God's life force. Now, God's life force is a type of energy that God has. And God has, of course, how many energies? Yes, an infinite amount of energies, but obviously some energies are more important. They have hierarchy, if you like, that way, than others. And the life energy, the life force that comes from God, obviously is a key ingredient in all creation. So it's something that God obviously has defined how mathematically and scientifically how these energies can be transferred. Firstly, from God to us, and then also in terms of procreation. So let's look at how it works. So life energy is given to living creatures. Now, I must also state, though, that it's not just living creatures that are governed by the life principle, because even the very smallest particles all have life in them. Just the fact that they move is an indication that energy, some kind of force, exists to make them move. Does that make sense? Like all the particles move around. And that is an indication there must be energy supplied to these things. So you could say there's sort of life in everything, including all non-living matter contains some life. But here we're talking specifically about a force that comes from God that is given to living creatures and therefore also is allowed to be transferred from living creature to living creature. Does that make sense? Now, the human soul is an interesting creature. And here we're not talking about the human body, the spirit or the physical bodies, but I'm talking specifically about the human soul. Because the human soul is a creature that where each individual human soul has received directly from God life force at the time of its creation. So this means that before you became aware of your existence, you were created, and at that moment in time, God transferred directly from God's soul to yours this life force. It's interesting because the human soul, as far as we're aware, and I still believe it to be true at this stage, does not procreate. Every other creature procreates. Every other living creature procreates in some way, but the human soul does not. So God's highest... Now that's as far as we're aware. Of course, there might be something that engages in the human soul at some form in the future that allows the human soul to create human souls. And therefore, the human soul would be, in that stage, procreating. Does that make sense? Supplying life energy from itself to its progeny. But at this stage, that is not occurring. And therefore, at this stage, the human soul is not a creature that can procreate, can transfer life energy to another human soul. And my feelings are that we have to get into a much more developed state before that will be even able to be contemplated to be possible. But the rest of creation, the life energy is transferred. And this happens for all types of creatures and living matter. So you sort of look at a tree or a You know, those most of it has seeds or some kind of nodules that allow for procreation to continue. And so most living matter obviously has ways to transfer this life energy. So in that regard, once the life energy is given to the first of them, every subsequent one, basically it's a transference of the life energy. So life is promoted, nurtured, respected and sustained. Of course, there are, you could say, exceptions to this, but those exceptions are really only based upon the human condition, they're governed by human desires in particular, and or by processes that may occur in the universe due to interactions between matter that cause certain things to die. But in each case, other things get created. So there is this constant sustenance of the creative process as a result. Imbalance is prevented and repaired. Right now, inside of your bodies, you have about 150,000 base pairs in the human genome that are actually flawed and don't repair. Now, what do you think that might be caused by? Probably emotion, right? Given that we've learned a bit about love and emotion. But it's interesting that even though that is the case, most of us don't end up with an ear down here and a nose over there and so forth, do we? So even though there is these flaws, it can cope with the flaws. Even though the human has degraded its condition that causes the flaws in the replication of the genome, it still can maintain its condition, which is interesting in itself, isn't it? It just shows you that God's even built into the process the fact that you can degrade and still it's trying to repair itself. The other beautiful thing about this one is that if you release, as a human, release the emotions that caused degradation, the body, the human body, will attempt to repair itself. So in fact, by the time you reach the at-one-ment condition with God, you'll find your body no longer has 150,000 flawed, irreparable parts of the genome. Does that make sense? As a result. And matter that dies, if you could call it dies, where the life force leaves it. So like a tree, when the life force leaves it, it loses its leaves, it dies. As soon as it dies, all of the rest of the environment is created to deconstruct that tree and turn it into food for other living creatures. Isn't that an interesting idea or concept? That as soon as, for whatever reason, something dies, it's transformed through a decomposition process, in the case of a tree, into matter for living creatures. This is why building buildings that are dead is not a good idea. Because when you build a dead building, God's laws are all going, let's destroy that and make it matter for living creatures again. Right? And so this, but the life principle enforces that to occur as well. So this is about the attempt to sustain life. Now, of course, the sustenance of life is with the human in the mix, obviously, is very dependent upon the human's condition as to how life will be sustained. But if the human's not in the mix, there are natural processes at work to sustain the life of creatures of higher creations. So creatures that have high amount of laws usually also have a high amount of availability of other life-giving forces to sustain them. And so this is where, you know, humankind often living out of harmony with this one, obviously, because we're frequently destroying things that we don't need to destroy, but we destroy it to create non-living things. And unfortunately, a lot of the times in the process of our destruction, we're causing a lot of problems here in this life principle. We even go to the full extent of abortion, which is an actual, you can see, is a very big area of that we need to correct. on the planet with regard to the life principle. Okay, so let's look at our examples again. Oop, I better just, every 4 hours that does that, I just need to make sure that I press a key. There we go. Stop that from happening. Unfortunately, I can't permanently stop it from happening because I've put a thing in there that doesn't resize the screen, and it's a function issue. I've made a functional issue where I can't set the screen to be the right size without resetting the whole monitor and therefore losing my settings in other areas. Anyway, someone wasn't thinking again. Yeah. Anyway, so gravity creates an atmosphere, pulls in the atmosphere, prevents creatures requiring the atmosphere from leaving the atmosphere due to physical centrifugal forces, which we discussed in the previous example of gravity. So therefore, the life is sustained. All the requirements that we have for life, including the oxygen in the system and so forth, the nitrogen in the system, everything that's required for life, even the things that are required for life for the trees, which is, you know, carbon dioxide, right? It's required for them. They breathe that in, breathe out oxygen, adds oxygen to the atmosphere. We breathe in the oxygen, breathe out the carbon dioxide. The trees breathe that in, breathe that out. You can see that the whole Earth is really breathing. And what we breathe out, our waste, is the food for trees to breathe in. Isn't it amazing? It's such a symbiotic thing too, isn't it? But gravity allows all of that to, of course, continue. Interesting thing about aerodynamics is it requires knowledge, whether that's instinctual or investigated knowledge, of the law before flight can be obtained. So that prevents accidental deaths through attempts to fly that you didn't understand the law before you began. Huh? That'd be great. Imagine if that wasn't there, you'd go, you know, there'd be no, let's say you had no knowledge to fly. So you go out one day and you start flapping your arms and you fly, you know, there's no knowledge to fly, you just flap your arms or whatever it is. That in reality, you accidentally created a wing or something and off you went flying one day. But because the law was inconsistent and the life principle wasn't in it to sustain life, and the next day, let's say the law changed because the truth principle wasn't in it, as you go out and do the same thing and you die. It wouldn't make it very easy for a scientist to discover a truth, would it? Like, if one day he does one thing and it works and the next day he does the same thing and he dies from it, you'd have a lot of deaths in the scientific community as a result. Wouldn't be very helpful to the human race. So the reality is the life principle is there to preserve our life. So everything's operating to preserve it, including the fact that we can't even use laws we don't know much about properly. Until we learn more about them, we can't use them well, right? And that even is a process of sustaining our life, sustaining our existence as well. This one here, many of you had a question about this, how the soul prevents the degradation of a soul, the compensation principle, which is based on the life prevents the degradation of a soul to the point the soul cannot sustain its own life. Now, many of you have asked, how does that happen? Well, how it happens is the compensation principle basically provides a painful feedback mechanism to the soul, telling it when it's out of harmony with love. Now, if that painful feedback mechanism wasn't provided, you could theoretically degrade your soul to the point where life would not be possible. You could make it so. See, for the soul to really function, and this is something that many of you still not grasping well, so we need to talk about it a little bit. So here's your complete soul. For the soul to function, there's got to be energy passing through it. You follow? Energy is E, energy. And it's got to be passing through. It's got to be in motion. So for the soul to really function, to express itself, to live, there has to be emotion passing through it. Right? Now imagine for a moment that you degrade your soul so much that no longer can the energy flow. Imagine you could get to that point, if you could. Theoretically, if you get to that point, the soul would no longer be able to sustain life. So the fact that compensation exists, it sort of gets us to the stage where the energy stops flowing and it gets shut down more and more and more, but there's another energy that gets created through the shutdown process, and that's the energy of pain. Pain starts increasing. The beauty of that is that pain's telling us that we're doing the opposite to what life would suggest we should be doing. So this now corrects our behavior of shutting down our emotion. All right? So it helps correct this. And that's a good thing, because theoretically we could shut down our emotion so far that in the end our soul might even die. Now it's not known whether that's possible or not at this stage, because no one's ever done it enough, because to do it would require avoiding an infinite amount of pain potentially. So of course nobody's ever done it, but it theoretically might be possible. If there wasn't the pain, it would definitely be possible. If the pain didn't exist as a feedback mechanism, then you'd keep destroying your own soul, not realizing that there is a point where your whole soul might disappear completely as a result of your own self-destruction. So the life principle says, no, God's wanting your soul to continue existing, and so God wants to give you a mechanism telling you that what you're doing that's out of harmony with your own soul's existence. And the life principle does that. Let's look at Earth systems. They maintain themselves and repair themselves and right themselves even under extreme pressure. Man, humankind puts extreme pressure on this planet, and yet it's still sustaining life. Right? 7 billion people pumping out huge amounts of pollution every single day, whole lot of toxic substances every single day. Our emotions themselves frequently are toxic substances every single day. Right? That's probably the highest toxic substance on the planet, actually, our emotions. And yet, the Earth is still trying to regain equilibrium, trying to correct everything, trying to supply the energy to keep us alive, trying to, like, still doing it even under extreme duress. An example of the life principle at work. Human body. Man, the human body actually is the most complex of all physical creations. The spirit body is the most complex of all metaphysical creations, and the spirit body and the physical body exist in the what you would classify as anywhere between, they're in the physical universe, which includes the earth, the hells, right up to the 35th sphere. Right? And of course the soul doesn't exist there, but we'll talk about that later. But the human bodies, the physical body and the spirit body, so we're here talking, this is why I've used the term bodies, not referring to two of us, but rather referring to both of our bodies. Both of our bodies, both the physical and the spiritual bodies, have millions of automatically inbuilt detoxifying, correcting systems and eliminating systems, correcting the stress and strain that we place upon it due to our unfunctioning emotional state in the majority of cases. And honestly, we can put up with so much strain. You should see the spirits in the hells, how much strain their bodies are under, and yet their bodies are still maintained. It's remarkable how far we can degrade and yet still maintain our spirit body in particular. As far, you can actually see what happens on Earth is, for the majority of us, is we've got into an unloving state, obviously, out of harmony with the principle through our emotional condition. And so we degrade our body to the point, by the time we're 70 or 80, we die, right? That's caused by us living out of harmony with the life principle and the love principle and the truth principle. We degrade our own body, physical body, to the point of death. So our physical body can no longer handle the correction process. It can no longer handle the detoxifying and eliminating processes, because we've destroyed it so much through this emotional shutdown process. We've destroyed it so much that it dies. But the physical body, the life principle, gets eliminated from the physical body, but it still remains in the spirit one. And you know, you can degrade your body even further than that. in the spirit life. And many, in fact most, who pass do degrade their body even further by choices they make and so forth. So the spirit body is even more remarkable than the physical one, because it can cope with even greater amounts of hardship and strain and yet not destroy itself. Just remarkable. If you examine people on earth sometimes who are in this state before death, you know, just before death if they're of old age, you know, oftentimes they're immobile, they really can't do much, their body eliminating systems are starting to close down, this is what causes their death many times. And these kind of things sort of happen quite naturally when we start shutting down emotion, of course. But it's remarkable that the spirit body can even go further than that and get destroyed even further and still sustain life. It's just remarkable. And at this stage, you know, nobody has ever, not a single person, has ever destroyed their own physical, spiritual body through a process of their emotional shutdown. Not a single person. It is physically possible. Yeah, it is physically possible. But the reality is nobody's done it. You know why? Because of the life principle. The compensatory effects of doing it are so painful that nobody's ever contemplated that amount of pain. So they can't do it. They don't finish up doing it. Interesting. So it's very interesting, the bodies, the spirit body being the highest of all of God's physical creations. Obviously not the highest of God's soul-based creations. We are, the soul is a different creation altogether. But the spirit body, the human spirit body, is by far the biggest and most complicated system in the physical universe. Billions and billions and billions and billions of laws govern its operation. Far more laws than govern the operation of the physical universe itself. So what do they do, these life principles? They allow any creation to receive God's life force and then be able to supply that life force through its own procreative ability. The life principles ensure that life remains sacred and that all mechanisms are created to support and sustain life. That's its purpose. Now, like all the laws, every single law can be interfered with by the human. So the same applies here. We can interfere with it. But interestingly enough, even with the soul in particular, we can't interfere it to the point of the soul's destruction. So that's fortunate that God put that in it, right? Otherwise, we could easily be destroyed through the process. Yeah. Now, I just want to raise this issue with you, that humans frequently justify, minimize desires, attitudes, emotions, and thoughts. And remember, desires, attitudes, emotions, thoughts, and actions are all energy in motion, therefore measurable by God's systems. Right? So what do? We justify war, big issue, abortion. We justify healthcare, which a lot of times is about suppressing emotion while trying to maintain health, which is an oxymoron in itself, right? It's not possible, but we think it's possible. Things like eating meat, pollution, fear of emotions, fear of death. They're all things that are shutting down the life principle. So these are all ways that we use to shut down the life principle. And I've just got to keep an eye on my timings here. It is right on your list here, darling. Is that right? 1424 is... Yes, okay. Let's move on to the development principles. Sorry, I can't answer your questions at this stage, but we've got to move forward. So what's the development principle? The development principles allow each creation principle and law to evolve, grow, and change positively. And by the way, they also, they not just allow positive change, but they actually encourage positive, but they also allow devolvement, negative change as well, by ensuring expansive change is forced upon all matter. And in fact, when we talk about scope principles tomorrow, you'll see that actually the commingling of matter to create higher creations with higher laws that govern them is actually a natural process. So the reality is, not only is all matter individually expansively changed, but we can also create from the combinations of matter new matter or new creatures, which is a part of this expansive change. Growth is supported, encouraged, and sustained. So if you examine anything, I still find it remarkable looking at some things on the planet with regard to how harsh the environments are, and yet they can still grow. like some of the wattles around our homes, we haven't had much rain for 7 or 8 months and there's still new leaves on them. how does that happen? I dig down as far as I can dig and I can't find a drop of water, but there must be something there keeping them alive, right? Just shows you that growth is supported and sustained even under the most difficult of circumstances and conditions. Now, at one time where we live used to be a rainforest, and we've turned it into almost a wasteland, we collectively, the human race, and yet still it sustains some forms of life. Remarkable. Positive development evolution occurs for all matter. So if you examine the earth, if you took mankind away from this earth at this stage, all of humankind got out of the system, within 1,000 to 2,000 years, a lot of the earth would be recovered. Right? Now, the deserts possibly would not. They might take 20,000 years or 30,000 years to recover, right? Because of the amount of damage that's been done there. But the other areas, where we live, it would probably recover in 200 or 300 years. If your higher rainfall areas would recover much sooner. But it's interesting that the positive development and evolution and the recovery process also occurs through this development principle. But also the positive development is also with regard to the expansive properties of the matter. So each form of matter has properties that determine what it's possible that matter can do, how it can combine with other matter and so forth. And what happens when this development principle enforces change upon the properties of the matter themselves? So each material also has changes that occur to it over time, which is another fascinating thing that occurs that you can observe a lot in the spirit world. So increasing capacities can develop. This means that a capacity that was available to the human body today, potentially if we lived in harmony with these principles, in 200 years' time, the human body could be capable of far more. So at the moment that they say we're using around 5 to 10% of our brain, I don't know, brain scientists is about that, is it? Yeah, apparently. Now, if it's 5%, 10% of our brain that we're using now, and imagine we start to deal with whatever causes that, then imagine what 100% usage of our brain might be like. It's hard to imagine, really, isn't it? You don't know how fast you'll be able to think, how fast you'll be able to process, how fast you'll be able to feel emotion, how fast you'll be able to grow, how fast you'll be able to move, what kind of laws you might be able to engage in that process, your understanding of things, how much that might improve. Your mathematical abilities, which obviously are part of how God communicates, must be affected by that. So obviously that's all going to change. The ability for your spirit body to communicate with your physical body, and therefore your spirit body, your intentions, control the mechanisms of your body, so you can shut down your body. If you don't have water for a month, you just shut down your body so it doesn't need water for a month. That kind of thing. You don't know what the body is capable of, right? Because we're measuring everything through the flawed condition. But increasing capacities can develop as the development principle allows for these increasing capacities, but also allows for the decreasing capacity. What happened between a mon and a man, 100% use of brain, and us, 10% use of our brain? Something happened, right? Devolution of mankind happened, obviously. So something must have also allowed for that to occur. Right? So the development principles allow that, but they actually support growth. So they're supporting growth, and we, with our shut down emotional state, are trying to degrade. Really, that's what we're trying to do, trying to degrade. And yet the development principles are saying, you've got to grow. And so you end up in this state where eventually we become even cognizant that we're shutting down and we stop doing that. Right? So it's a very fascinating principle. Now, it also reflects upon the self-determination of the human soul, this principle. Basically, the human soul, the only creature with free will, is now allowed to make its own choices and decisions about how it improves or how it degrades. So this development principle allows us to actually have self-determination. We can decide what we want. We can either grow or degrade, and we can decide upon either. Now, we could also theoretically remain stagnant, but it's going to be pretty hard, considering that the development principle says you've got to grow. So you'd have to try hard at staying stagnant. Right? So what do we see examples of this? What does gravity do? Gravity's existence allows my investigation and development while remaining safe and secure. I'm not afraid of flying off the planet. I'm not afraid of taking a step and it being a huge leap that kills me. I'm not afraid of so many things. I'm safe and secure. I can now experiment. I can now find out new things. So even gravity is a developmental law. It allows for development. If it didn't exist in the form that it exists and with the permanence that it exists, it would not allow for development. Aerodynamics. Knowledge of the law allows enhanced form of travel and experiences. So again, allows for our development. Of course, if we come up with a vehicle that wasn't so polluting, that would even be better, wouldn't it? That would allow for our development even further. Let's have a look at human bodies again. The sperm and the egg. Isn't it quite simple? Put the sperm and the egg together. When you say simple, it's like complicated laws, but the principle is simple. It's like put one cell together from one person, another cell from another person, put them together, and you know what they do? They splice and combine. There's a whole heap of laws governing that, and they form a new DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid, new ones formed. A chain that determines what you're going to grow. You know, whether you're going to have blue eyes, brown eyes, whether you're going to have brown hair, black hair, blonde, whatever. How high you're going to be. All these different things are determined through that process. So the development principle allows something to start just as a single cell or two cells and end up being you. Well, it's not you, is it? It's just an animal that your soul possesses, isn't it? That's what the body is, isn't it? It's like an animal form that your soul possesses. So you are not that, but it's just remarkable that this body can come from the most tiniest of the seeds, isn't it? Yeah. In the first century, I used to say, you know, the mustard seed, which is, as you know, is a very small seed, right? It's a tiny seed, grows into be a very big tree. So I used to refer to the mustard seed because people could see that it was a very small seed and yet it had big outcomes, right? Referring to this principle, of course. The woman's womb supports the environment of development. Imagine if it didn't, you know, the sperm and the egg get together and then it wouldn't have anywhere to develop. Wouldn't have a home to make its first transitional stages of development to the point where it can breathe oxygen and process food and so forth that it needs to sustain life. Right? The womb then becomes, the whole co-creation of the womb is actually supported by the development principle. Right? It allows reflexes and instinct to develop. And also instinct to grow, like, as I said, because of new potentials that the development principle allows. So we could go on again with what the law does, this development principle does with the different laws. Compensation. Encourage me when I'm out of harmony with the law to get into harmony with the law, but encourage me to develop and change. How does it do that? It gives me positive feedback when I'm going in a positive direction, and it gives me positive feedback in the form of pain when I'm going in a negative direction. That's what it does. So now I can measure which direction I probably should go in, which actually enhances my possibility of positive development. As we can see, very clever laws, eh? Divine and development of universe. The entire universe allows positive and negative development, but supports and encourages only positive development. So it allows both, but it really is, in the end, going to create only positive direction. Now, I'm going to skip over some of those. I just want to say this. So development principles allow any creation to develop and change by ensuring that the mechanism for change and adaptation exists within the creation itself and within the controlling laws. Now, this is something I'd like to talk about a little bit more with you, because it's quite interesting, actually, how God allows development to occur when you consider the interaction between law and creations. So an example, let's have an example. We have an ant. Sure. So here's an ant. I don't know how we draw him. He's got six legs. There's an ant. Now, how does this affect that? Well, firstly, the ant itself has inbuilt in it. Now, the ant is quite a complex creation, actually. You imagine it's got quite a large number of molecules made up of quite a large number of elements which all commingle in different ways to produce new laws, and those new laws create the creation. Therefore, you could say it's like a DNA for humans. There's also similar for them, of course. So now we have the cell replication process structured in such a way that allows for that ant to exist in the form that it exists and so forth. So there's a whole lot of internal laws governing it, right? These laws mean that this ant has properties. One of the properties is that it can change, given some external forces. So the example is like, you have an external force of temperature, just temperature differential. Well, ants will adapt to large number of temperature differentials. But there is a certain extreme that they reach where life is not possible. But they are actually capable of handling far higher temperatures than humans. Well, why is that? Because that's the properties of the creature itself. And what I'm suggesting here is the development principles ensure that the properties of the creature continue to change, which means that it continues to be able to live in more and more extreme environments. Now, of course, this is very dependent upon the human's condition, because the human, being the governing force of all of it, as we'll learn later, governs the potential properties of all other creatures. But it's interesting that the development principle allows properties internal to the creature to change, as well as external forces to change. And the external forces can frequently encourage properties of the creature to change. And so when God supplies extra love to the system, the love itself automatically causes the creation of new creations, new living creatures. And this is how, in fact, your body got created in first instance, right? The first human body. By an injection of more and more of God's love into the system, causing the internal properties of the creature to change to the point where now the soul can connect to it. So there must have been a time historically where the human soul couldn't connect, and therefore just an animal. You would have just had your body and your spirit body just like any other animal. Huh? But then God created it to the point where the properties of the creature changed so much that now the human soul could be connected to the bodies. Does that make sense? So now you have the birth of the human, the first self-aware creatures. Now, how rapidly God did that, it's probably done in an instant, right? Which means that it, from our perspective, it just would have looked like the human got created and the soul got connected. But it's through a whole heap of laws that that happened. Now, how do we frequently justify and minimize attitudes, desires, emotions and thoughts that oppose development? Well, even things like nostalgia is an interesting thing. We hang on to the past. You know, you want everything to stay the same. You wish the new didn't come along. You know, that even that feeling is against the principle. Opposing the release of emotions. The release of emotions are going to cause growth. So when you oppose the release of emotions, you're opposing development. Opposing the resolution of interpersonal issues. That's how you grow, by interacting with other creatures, in particular for us, the human creature, and you work through your issues, right? By opposing working through your issues, you're opposing growth. Opposing changes of family and friends. How common is that one? Probably most of you have listened to Divine Truth have had that one, right? Where somebody in your family said, "You idiot for listening," right? There's an example of something, somebody opposing growth, opposing the development principle. Opposing experimentation, placing financial matters ahead of development. How often is that one done? Most of you do that even today, right? You don't buy yourself extra time to work on your emotions. You buy yourself extra time to further degrade your emotions. Right? If you're in harmony with the development principle, you'd use your money to improve your emotional condition, not worsen it. So there's many examples there as well. So that's the end of our discussion about those two principles. As you can see, again, we're just touching the surface of it, aren't we? Okay. Well, myself and Lena are now going to change and swap over to the Q&A, and I'll get out your Q&As that you've given me and we'll start answering those. So now we're going to have the Life and Development Principles Q&A. Now, the first, what I'm going to do is have the first 15 minutes basically life principles, and the next 15 minutes basically will be the development principles. So we're going to start with the life principles with Kate's question. Thanks, Kate.
Okay, I think you've answered it a bit, but anyway, could you explain or give an example of how fear of emotions opposes life principles?
So you see from my previous example here that we drew on the board with the soul and how the soul actually functions, you can see that the soul functions through the cycling of emotional energy between the two halves of the soul. And also it functions with interaction outside of itself through emotional energy being projected outside of itself to control its environment. That's how it functions. So when you shut down emotions, you're shutting down this internal cycling of energy between the soul, the two halves of the soul, and even inside of one half of the soul, you're shutting it down. But once you shut down one half, you then make it impossible for the other half to connect to you as well. And then on top of that, you have less emotional force, emotional energy flowing out of you to the external environment. Now, you can see straight away that if you're shutting down the flow of energy, energy is life, and so obviously you're shutting down your own life as a result. Your ability to live in an enhanced condition is automatically shut down. So it's immediately out of harmony with the life principle to shut down emotions. By the way, it's also immediately out of harmony with love principle. It's immediately out of harmony with the truth principle. It's immediately out of harmony with development principle. It's immediately, can you see that if it's out of harmony with one principle, it's probably out of harmony with most of them, right? Mm. And that's why I'm saying to you, if you learn to live in harmony with these principles, you automatically live in harmony with many laws. Now, shutting down of emotions, the soul works emotionally, and once you start to shut down one emotion, there is a suppression, an automatic suppression of all emotion. The way the soul's been built is that it's incapable of shutting down one emotion without the suppression of all emotion. Right? Now, that's one of the principles that I've talked to you about when I talk to you about how the human soul works, and that you can go through those on the website or on YouTube. But if you can examine that further, you see that if I start suppressing just one emotion, let's say I suppress anger. Now, many of you like suppressing anger, right? Because you've been told over years it's bad, and you've probably got punished for it when you're a child and so forth, and it's not spiritual to have anger and so forth and so forth, so you shut down anger. But shutting down anger creates a blockage within the soul that disallows the cycling of other emotions. So as soon as you shut down one emotion, you are actually in disharmony with the life and development principles automatically. Right? That makes sense?
Yep. Yeah.
You want to say, Mary? She wants to come up.
My sock is gone.
Your sock is gone.
Yeah, I'll speak softly. You're also in disharmony with the life principle in that you affect the life force of everything around you. So the creatures that don't have souls
and
so on.
I can't hear you very well.
No, I've found that all day, but you can hear me, can't you? Yeah. Yeah, so affecting the life in your physical body is also the energy, this shutdown of any emotion prevents the life force that's sustaining your body from flowing as well, and it affects all of God's other creation. It works against the life force that's in all other creation. Hmm. Yeah, just want to add that.
Can we get a windsock for Mary? Is there one around somewhere? You know where it is. Yep, no worries. Alice, where are you? If we have the mic back at Alice.
Hi, how does the question begin?
An example of the law of compensation given. You got that one?
In life and development principles, an example of the law of compensation given is that it prevents the degradation of a soul to the point that the soul cannot sustain its own life. How is that accomplished?
Yes. Now, can you see from my description, I've probably already explained how that's accomplished?
Yes.
But there's also this additional factor, obviously, that when the emotion is suppressed here in the soul, right, what happens, the compensation is now causing us pain as a result of that. Now, pain is an emotion in itself. So it has a specific kind of energy. It's mathematically defined by God. And that starts flowing in the soul and then gets transferred to the bodies. Right? So as a result of that now, since the pain is now flowing, it's now a measuring system. We're going inside of ourselves, this is causing my degradation. The compensation principle feeds back to you that it's causing degradation. And so what it does is it prevents you from degrading yourself too much. Right? Now, many of you also experience that even in your physical body, right? Your physical body, you know, let's say you start putting on weight. At first, it's probably not too bad, right? You sort of think, oh, no, I still like eating. I still like, you know, doing the things that put on weight because I need the food or whatever. But you get to the point where you're so big that your whole life is really uncomfortable now, right? What happens then? You start going, well, maybe I need to change my lifestyle. Maybe I need to change something that's causing me to get this way. Now, of course, there's emotions of anger that cause that. And you may not know that, but at least you start trying to change your lifestyle to get that equilibrium back. Does that make sense? Let's say you got a disease of some kind. The same applies. You get a disease, if the disease, what we call manageable, we usually ignore it, right? Until such a point as we get there to the point where we're now, it's so much pain, we can't ignore it anymore. So what do? We start trying to take action to fix it. Now, most of our actions are physical, unfortunately, because we're not educated about the emotions causing most of these problems. But at least we're doing something. And the reality is our improvement in our love condition towards ourselves may open us up to what the real cause is at some point in the future even. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So this is how the soul itself and even our physical form, we get to the point where we want to resolve some things. Now, with our physical form, there's certain things we ignore. One of the things we ignore is old age and death. Right? We think that's a natural process. And so what do? We believe that when we get older, we look older and we start feeling older and we start dying, we think, oh, that's normal, so I'm not going to do anything about that. That's what we do, isn't it? We basically say we can't do anything about it. It's, you know, with these other things like getting bigger or having a disease, sometimes we think we can do something about those things. But when it comes to death, we think you can't do anything about that. And because we already think we can't do anything about that, we automatically do not do anything about it. And because we don't do anything about it, we don't learn about what causes it, naturally our physical body then dies. So can you also see that when we ignore the principles, for example, ignoring the feedback system that our very mirror is giving us, right, we are now also not going to be in harmony with the life and development principles. And this is what I see humankind doing. We're often open to seeing things like weight changes, disease fluctuations, sicknesses, illnesses. But when it comes to things that we think are unavoidable, like accidents and death, we believe there's nothing that the soul has to do about those things, and nothing could be further from the truth, actually. But we ignore it, and so naturally we finish up passing. But even when we pass, we're still alive, so we still haven't been able to degrade our soul to the point where we're not alive anymore. So it's quite remarkable how far God's gone to actually keep us conscious and alive. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks for your question, Alice. Pierre, you're next. This is question number one for you, Pierre, and then number three. Thanks, mate.
That's life principles, right?
Life principles, yes.
Yeah.
Question number one and three.
Is God's life force the same thing as they called the odic force in the 19th century?
That's not what I've got for your life principles. So you must be somewhere else. Let me just see where you are.
Sorry, maybe I mixed up the
order. One I've got says to be in harmony with life principle.
Yes. Okay. So to be in harmony with God's principle, everything we create should be self-maintaining and repairing, like garden, building, organization, services.
Correct. That's an interesting thought, isn't it? How many things do we actually build that are self-maintaining and self-repairing? I would say close to zero at this stage, right? And yet to be in harmony with the principle, we'd actually have to build things that are only self-maintaining and repairing. Now, most of us don't feel we're clever enough to do that, so we finished up doing the lower form of creation, of course. But we'll talk more about that, actually, because many of you, when it comes to things like art, when we come to functioning economy, we'll talk a bit about art. You create a whole heap of things from dead things and then hope that God doesn't destroy them, and God's already destroyed them from the moment you had a thought to do it. So this is a problem with many of our creations, is we're creating out of harmony with the principle. So because we're out of harmony principle, God's automatically trying to destroy our creation, automatically. And then we get real frustrated, don't we? We go, damn it, like, why is this happening? Why is that happening? Why am I spending so much time on maintenance? People do that with their gardens, right? They create a garden, then they got to water it every day. Out of harmony with this principle. Because if we're in harmony with principle, it would be self-maintaining. We wouldn't have to water it. Does that make sense? So we have to design it differently so that it maintains itself. so that it captures the necessary water automatically, so that it automatically feeds itself, automatically waters itself. I don't have to do anything. All I do is create and go on to another creation and go on to another creation, and I don't have to look back and go, now that one that I just created back there, that's all gone again now. I've got to go back and fix that. We won't have to do that. God doesn't do that. God doesn't go back and go, oh, I need to fix that. I made a mess there. All right. But this is our problem, is because we're not creating in harmony with God's principles, we are going to have to go and maintain our creations. And the problem with that is that you get to a point where the maintenance of your creation takes so much time that you're unable to create new creations. Now, if the maintenance of your creation is taking too much time, it means the creation itself is out of harmony with God's principles. Hence, myself and Mary have never created a forum. Can you see why? To maintain it would take too much of our time. It'd be a regular thing I have to do over and over and over again. That's out of harmony with the principle of creation here. You see? Facebook wouldn't exist, actually, if we were in harmony with this principle. Facebook would not have actually exist, because it's a huge waste of time with nothing getting created. And you're not even having relationships on Facebook, are you? No, they're just interactions, usually in facade, interactions, feeding each other's addictions, but you're not actually physically creating anything. You're sitting down on your bum, typing something into the computer, and that barely creates anything at all, doesn't it? What does it do in the external environment? What good does it give to mankind? Aside from the communicative effect, but it's not even real communication, is it? Because everyone's in the facade making out that, oh, wow, this and isn't that, man, and a little short bit here and short bit there. That's not real communication. So at the end, like I say, it wouldn't even exist if we were in harmony with the principle. Sorry about that, guys of makers of Facebook, but that's the way it goes. And your third question. Does God supply?
Oh my God, it's completely mixed up. Okay, that's the last one here. Does God supply? I cannot read more.
You wrote it better here. You want me to read it?
Does God supply us with his life force only at the time of our conception? No, I know it's the creation of our soul, mm-hmm. but or are multiple occurrences all the time?
Mm-hmm. If he stops, will we die? Yeah, good question. No, once God supplies a life principle to a creation, that life principle remains in the creation unless some external force changes that. But God won't. So what that means for our soul is that God supplied at the time of the creation of our soul, the life force, and as far as we're aware, that's never going to be taken away from us, because God just supplies it and it's supplied. Theoretically, though, some external force may occur that might destroy the soul, but as yet, no external force is strong enough, because the human soul is the most powerful of all the forces. Right? So in practice, it's not possible to destroy the soul for that reason. So yes, what happens at the time of conception is not the same as the energy that gets to the supplied to the human soul, is it? Conception is just a process by which two physical bodies get together, sperm and egg, they combine, commingle, cause a third entity. That entity, due to the womb, develops in an environment to the point where it can sustain life. It's then born, as the saying goes, but the life principle began and was transferred at the time of conception from the parents. But it's only the bodies of the parents that are doing that. As soon as that physical form is created, in the case of a human soul, the human soul has to connect to it, otherwise it will die. And this is the reason why there's so many deaths with regard to IVF, because IVF, there's so many hit and misses with regard to it, because there's not many human souls that want to commingle with a created body that's outside of a womb. Right? There's some, but not many. So there's a lot of those die, of course. Yeah, a lot of those automatically pass because they're attracted. The conception process, the soul is attracted, the undeveloped soul here we're talking about, is attracted by the character and nature of the parents. And it can't feel that character and nature of the parents, right, very easily until the cell is in the womb of the mother. Now it can feel it. Now it has the potential to connect with it. So this is why they find that many get taken out, and in between taken out of their process and then fertilized in the mother, in between the time of those processes, many of them die. Right? But the reality is, in a normal process, that wouldn't happen because the soul would be instantly attracted to the conceived cells. Right? And so therefore, there would be more likelihood of those that conception surviving, because it's the soul of the attracted soul that forms the part of that energetic system to keep the cells alive. Does that make sense? Just a bit of an aside. Okay, now that was life principles. Let me sort myself out here. Okay. And we're going to only get about 10 minutes, I think, on development principles, but here we go. Now, I've just got to select. Man, you've got quite a good few questions here. David Raisman, where are you? Over there. Can we have your question about development principles? And Fab, can we have your question about development? So after David, we go to Fab.
So do you mean?
Yep.
So do you mean that the mechanisms for change, though created within me, only exist as a potential due to free will and not an inbuilt function?
Yes, it's an interesting way you've termed it, but I would say it's an inbuilt function in the sense that the potential is an inbuilt function. So I wouldn't. So what Dave is really asking is, like, obviously the soul has specific mechanisms for change that's inbuilt in it. Now, those changes can only be embraced by a certain condition. Like, we have to meet certain conditions before the changes can occur. Does that make sense? Conditions have to be met before the change can occur. But the potential for the conditions to cause the change is already inbuilt in the soul. Now, we'll learn more about that in the scope discussion, how that potential exists. So basically what I'm suggesting is the inbuilt functions of the soul include the potential for change and include how external things can influence that change. An example of that is the reception of God's love. So God created inside of your soul the potential to receive God's love as an inbuilt function. But that potential can only be embraced through the action of desire. That's the only way that the potential can be triggered. So if you do not have a desire to receive God's love, none of God's love can be received, but God's love may be received, could be received, if you engage the desire. Does that make sense? Yeah. So what we need to understand is the soul itself has been created with these potentials that are inbuilt inside of the souls. There are laws that govern what happens to the soul when you receive certain substances from outside of the soul. And by the way, just receiving the emotion of a loved one is a substance from outside of your own soul. For the majority of us, we're not perhaps with our soulmates, and so we're receiving an emotion that comes from outside of our own soul into our soul. Does that make sense? That's a substance. Now, what happens inside of my soul when I receive that substance is determined by the soul's inbuilt functions, which are all defined by law. So what happens to you when you receive God's love is defined by law. But it's only a potential, because it also as part of the definition, requires desire to be triggered before the potential can be realized. Yeah. That's an example of the mechanisms being inbuilt, the potential being inbuilt, the law being governing the potential inbuilt, but not yet actuated, because desire is the mechanism by which actuation occurs. Okay, so if we go to Fab, now just find yours, Fab. Okay, this is development principle one. Yep.
Yeah, so does this mean that because of this development principle, everything has to change? Or even if our desire is not, if it's our desire isn't for, not to change?
Correct. Now, that has pretty big ramifications, actually, on our life. And this is where six fear spirits are very concerned. Because what they're noticing is that they themselves are not actually changing. They haven't realized that it's only because of their lack of desire that has stopped their growth, stopped their change, because the mechanisms for change are all inbuilt. But what this principle means is that everything will have to change. So sooner or later, they'll have to actuate the desire. The trouble with that is that they don't know what's going to happen if they don't. And this is where we get into these discussions in the sixth sphere about immortality. There's whole universities dedicated to the discovery of immortality, believe it or not, as a scientific principle. They're trying to find it scientifically, how to obtain immortality as a scientific discovery. Is actually, there's universities dedicated to it in the spirit world. Now, these universities, what they're trying to do is discover a way that they can physically embrace immortality without actually going through connecting with God. Because they don't believe they can connect to God, so that's not an option, right? So what they do is they're trying to work out physical ways to obtain the feeling of being immortal. In other words, knowing that you'll never die. At this stage, every sixth fear spirit believes that there is a potential of them dying. Now, of course, you can imagine that sort of sits as a big cloud over their life. And the longer they live in this sixth sphere state, the worse the cloud gets, which is an interesting compensatory effect trying to help them engage the principle of development.
So that's what you mean by it's forcing it onto them to, even if the desire is not to change, it's going to have to happen anyway.
Yes. As their desire is to not change, the cloud over their head of their worry about their lack of immortality and knowledge that they're not immortal continues to grow to such a point that they are now looking for anything to find out about immortality, even if it's what you call on the fringe of society. They're looking for it, right? And that's what makes them open to connecting to God. So many of them call the teachings of divine truth the fringes of society, just as they do on earth. And as a result of that, they leave it to the last thing they ever look at to find out whether there's something in it about their growth, right? But the reality is that even that condition of dissatisfaction with the fact that they are not able to determine whether they're immortal or not is actually causing them to develop a desire to grow. Yeah, it's a very interesting mechanism that applies right across the board, right up to the sixth sphere, even is still applying, still going to be triggered into growth at some point. Sooner or later, that cloud is going to get big enough to trigger your growth. Does that make sense? Mary?
Bit of a follow-up to Fab, spirit question. Without desire to change, doesn't degradation automatically occur due to disharmony with the development principle? And isn't degradation a devolution, therefore a change, and therefore in harmony with the development principle?
That sounds like an intellectual spirit answer, asking that question. Yep. Can you see the conundrum we get to when we don't have a soul-based understanding? It's sort of like you end up asking all of these cross-purposes thing, and it's very hard to resolve things from a logical perspective. But if we examine this question logically, we can see that to be in harmony with the development principle states that positive change is What was the statement of the principle? You remember? Positive change. I'll just jump to it, actually. Development principles. There we go. We just go down. He was saying it here. No, that's life principles. Sorry. Let's just get the development principles. Development principles. Expansive change is forced upon all matter. Growth is supported, encouraged and sustained. So what this means is that devolution is not, although it's allowed, according to the principle, it's not supported. Does that make sense? So even though it's allowed, it's not supported. So to be in harmony with the development principle, we have to support growth, not just support, like engage devolution, right? Devolution is allowed because the human soul has the ability to choose, and therefore it has the ability to choose its own devolution, right? Now, if we get to a state of like where we are in the sixth sphere, which is a state where we're basically not able to grow, we're worried that we're not able to grow, we're concerned about it, and now we're also concerned that there's a potential of devolution. Now, the reality is there is the potential of devolution, but remember, all evolution is surrounding also the love principle. It is highly unlikely that a sixth sphere spirit will choose to degrade in his condition of love, because to do so would create more suffering and pain in his life, which he would not want to do. Is that not true? It's highly unlikely that he will destroy the love that's in him and go for a lower condition of love. Highly unlikely. Particularly in his current environment in the sixth dimension, he will definitely not choose to do it. And so nobody in the sixth sphere chooses to do that. That means that they're able to sustain the amount of love that the perfect natural man can sustain. Now, it is not known how long that sustenance can occur. That is definitely not known. That's why they don't know whether they are immortal or not. They don't know how that long this energy can be sustained. But given the fact that it's love, it obviously will be able to be sustained for long periods of time. Now, in the time that it's sustained, it is highly unlikely that they will not develop some kind of dissatisfaction with the condition and therefore discover the higher form of love. And that's why there's been no sixth sphere spirit at this stage, that has died or has devolved into a lower creature. Because the love that's in them is sustained, and obviously the development principle is encouraging their expansive change through this compensatory effect of having the cloud over their head of not knowing they're immortal or not. And as a result, they now start to investigate things. Now, and if all of those six sphere spirits, or the six sphere spirit who's asked the question, thinks about it, he has been involved in the investigation of immortality. Now, if that's the case, then isn't he already on the process of positive development?
Just laughing now, yeah. At the recognition of that. Yeah,
so he's already sustained. So this is where sometimes our logic gets all mixed up, right? He's already actually in a process of positive development. It's just not very rapid because there isn't the engagement of the cause of development beyond the sixth sphere, which is the reception of divine love. So while his growth is not rapid, it doesn't mean that there has not been growth. And therefore, it is highly unlikely, even more unlikely, that devolution could occur. Right? The only six-sphere spirit that would be possible to devolve is a six-sphere spirit who has no desire to investigate immortality. And as yet, I haven't met one. And I don't know if he has, but but I haven't. What's his comment there?
No, just the comment that they're always wondering.
They're always
wondering. Recognizing that is actually a desire. Just didn't recognize that before.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it's a desire which actually is caused by this principle trying to motivate positive, further positive development. The problem is that they are not recognizing the mechanism by which it occurs because it's too fringe for them to consider. That's their problem. And what I'm suggesting is, no, you need to consider everything, including what the fringe is saying, because who knows, it might be the fringe is the problem. Not wanting to get involved in the fringe part of life, right? The Christian, the true Christianity part of life, which is the reception of God's love into the soul, which they all know about or have heard of generally, but don't see as a possible option for the scientific achievement of immortality. So it's an interesting question, yeah. All right, well, now we come to the conclusion of that. We're running around 15 minutes late at this stage, and I'll try to only keep it that way. So we'll have a 10-minute break, so it means we'll be back at 25 past 3, and we'll get started on our last two principles for the day, economy and function. Let's go.